Yeah, thanks a lot for having me here tonight. So I'm a German citizen. You can recognize by my accent, I am German, so don't worry. But as John said, I mean, science is so international, and I'm very pleased that Daryl Haggard is here, who could also give right away the same talk, because she's an American representative of the Galactic Center community. And there's actually a lot to be said about the Galactic Center. And nevertheless, I'm giving a public lecture here, and I have decided that I want to have something in that lecture for everybody. So I want to explain what is a black hole. I guess most of those people who have a badge, they should know what that is. I want to explain the story about the massive black hole in the Galactic Center. That's probably where most people who have a badge but do not belong to the astrophysics division get excited. And then there is that thing which we have discovered a few years ago, namely that we see something which is falling right into the black hole. And that is probably where everybody is excited about. So let me also say that physics is very different from astronomy. In physics, you have a laboratory and you can manipulate things. You have some sort of material, cables, whatever, and then you manipulate things. We can't do that in astronomy. We really have a hard time doing that. And maybe that thing which is falling into the black hole is a bit of physics, because we are throwing something at a black hole. I mean, it's not really us, but at least we can watch something falling towards a black hole. So it comes as close to be physics as it can be in astronomy. And that's maybe also why it's very good to have that at the APS meeting here. But let me start very simple. What is a black hole? A black hole is, I have three explanations of a black hole for you, all of which are different, but they are, of course, converging to the same physical phenomenon. And the simplest explanation is if you look at stars. The most famous stars, of course, the sun. It's the object which has just set. And a star for an astronomer is essentially a stable nuclear reactor. You can see here, that's the sun. And if you open the sun, you would see that in the middle of the sun, there's actually burning a fire. It's converting hydrogen to helium. And by means of the equation E equals mc square, that's the only equation you ever need in physics, by means of that equation, actually a bit of the mass is converted to radiation, and that is transported outwards and then radiated into the universe, heats up, for example, Savannah quite substantially in summer, I suppose. So, and that energy essentially is coming from that core in the sun. But it's a nuclear reactor, and a reactor always needs some fuel, and the fuel is finite with the sun. That reactor will not last forever. We know that the sun already is burning in that state for roughly 4.6 billion years. It will do so for another 3 billion years. So it's safe for our lives, but in the long run, we have to do something about it. That star will cease to exist because it will run out of fuel. What happens then to such a star? You can see here, that's shown here, that actually a star will blow up when it runs out of fuel. What happens is that the inner parts get compressed so that another nuclear reaction can ignite, whereas the atmosphere of the star is much larger. And you can see that most of the stars which are red in the evening sky, those are such stars which we call red giant stars. And those stars are essentially the ones which are really at the edge of dying. They have probably only just a few couple of 10 million years left before they really die. And what then happens depends a bit on the mass of the star. Here's our red giant, and if that star is less than 8 times the mass of the sun, then it will essentially get rid of its outer atmosphere in a very gentle way. That looks like a dramatic explosion, but it's not. It's actually just a star who has blown its atmosphere into space, and you can see here there remains a star in the middle, which we call a white dwarf, and it makes a very photogenic object. It's different if your star is more massive than 8 times the mass of the sun. I don't know who of you still owns a very old TV set which was an evacuated glass tube. Who still owns that? Somebody in that room? You want to upgrade to a flat screen? I have an experiment for you. It involves your TV screen and a hammer. So what will happen if you smash your TV screen? What will happen is that all the glass will fall into the center. That's, of course, not gravity acting there, but it's the ambient pressure of gas acting there. And you get an implosion, and all is fine, and you get the glass nice and compact. No, it's not. It will, of course, revert its direction and fly all the way out. So only do it if you have people in the room who you really want to hurt or something like that. So it's a dangerous experiment. Don't do that. Nevertheless, the same thing happens for stars. Essentially, the energy production ceases so quickly that that star will collide. It will collapse into something very massive, but the material then bounces back, and then of course you see something which we call an explosion. We call it a supernova. That's also, that term is of course has come to normal language, what a supernova, but we refer to that. It's a dying star, and that process actually happens rather, it's really the free fall time, so within a few minutes or so a star collapses and radiates then very, very brightly. Let me come a bit to these stellar remnants which we have in the middle of these dying stars. So, if you have a white dwarf, that was the thing which corresponds to the lighter stars. That object is roughly one solar mass and has the size of Earth. And one way to express that means that it has a very strong gravity is the escape speed. For example, in case you wanted to leave Earth, you need to be rather quick. You need to move by 12 kilometers per second. That means from here to the airport in 1 second or something like that. And that is a rather high speed, and no planes can actually do that, and that's why it's safe to fly planes, at least for that reason. So it's you don't reach those speeds. You actually need a rocket to reach that speed. And for a white dwarf, that escape speed is rather high. It's 10,000 kilometers per second. If I were to go with that speed, I would be in 1 second at home. Would be wonderful. So that's a high speed. If you go for a heavy star, then actually you have something which we call a neutron star. That is nothing else than a collection of protons and neutrons which are just packed together at the density of atomic nuclei. It has still roughly a solar mass, but it only has the size of a city. So maybe there's the size of Savannah here or so. And the escape speed for such an object can reach easily 200,000 kilometers per second. That is five times around Earth in 1 second. And these objects actually have a funny thing. They get smaller, the more heavy they are. Just imagine that would apply to yourself. You could go and eat on a buffet as much as you want, and you would get slimmer and slimmer while you eat. It would be fantastic. But unfortunately, we are not in that regime. But it means that the addition of material creates so much more gravity that the material is more compressed than actually the volume you add with the material. It's quite funny. But of course, that is you can already, if you're a physicist, you already know that cannot be stable. And there's actually a limit. And that limit, it is 1.4 solar masses. There, the escape speed reaches 300,000 kilometers per second, which is, of course, the speed of light. And that means that you would need to be faster than the speed of light to leave the object. We know that light moves at the speed of light, that's very obvious, and thus this object will be black. And we also know that nothing can move faster than light. No object can move faster than the speed of light, and that means that actually nothing can escape this object. It's a hole in that sense, it's a black hole. The term was coined by John Wheeler in 1963, I think. So I think that's actually quite a good description, and it's serious. I mean, you can enter a black hole, but you cannot come back. You can not send a postcard home, you cannot make a phone call home, because also the phone waves, of course, only travel at the speed of light. So you have to really be determined if you want to go to a black hole. But I mean, if you go with your spouse or something, it might actually be a romantic way of passing some time. That's the first explanation for a black hole. I have two more ones. And those ones require a bit of physics thinking. So this is of course, we don't do any calculations here, but it requires a bit of thinking, plus looking at diagrams. So Einstein, who was the inventor of the modern theory of gravity, essentially put at the top of his theory, gravity is the same as acceleration. If a high school student does that, essentially he will fail his exam, because teachers take a lot of understanding what the different forces are. And Einstein just equals those two forces. And what does he mean? He means that if you have a person standing here in a box on ground, it feels gravity and it's attracted downwards. And the same force the person is feeling if it's in that same box, but it's in outer space and that box is accelerating upwards. Then the person will be pushed downwards, and the claim is that those two forces are actually the same physical thing. It's crazy to think that, but Einstein did that. And what does it mean? It means here, I think it's not very well visible, you have here such a box where we have a light ray going from the left to the right side. If the box is in free space, without gravity, not accelerating, then the light ray will essentially just go from left to right. However, if you have the rocket accelerating, you can see that actually the light ray will hit the right wall a bit lower than the point where it left. And you can see that from the spaceship point of view, the light is actually falling downwards. So light is actually in that gravitating rocket falling downwards. And if Einstein is right, it means that gravity can deflect light. It means that light actually is falling downward. How can that be? And the way Einstein managed that in his theory is that space-time is curved. That's complicated. Nevertheless, it's something which is very simple to understand. We are living on a curved space. Namely, we're living on the surface of planet Earth. And if you're flying from Los Angeles to Paris, the plane is not taking the most direct route. The plane is taking a huge way around, because the direct route is, of course, through the body of Earth, which is not possible to follow. And that is the characteristic of a curved space-time, that the shortest distance is still a curved trajectory. And what Einstein's theory essentially is doing is it bends space around masses, and then the light rays are here just if you have a little test particle which goes around, then they get deflected, and that's the reason why you get this deflection. There's a mathematical theory behind that, but that's essentially what is happening. It means that mass can deflect light. You can see here a constellation of the winter sky, of the northern winter sky, that is Orion, and if there would be a gravitational lens moving fast in front of that, it should essentially do that. It's only the gravity of that object which distorts the image behind. And, well, Einstein predicted that effect, and it was Arthur Eddington who already in 1919 decided to have a look at that. It's remarkable. Einstein invented his theory in 1916, 1919, these experiments were done. At the same time, it was the First World War in Europe. Germany and England were not particularly good at this time, but still scientists were bridging that gap at the time. And Einstein was predicting that stars which are seen at the edge of the sun, they should be deflected by an incredibly small angle of 1.7 arc seconds. That's the angle here. And luckily, there is a coincidence that we can, from time to time, see the stars close to the sun. That is during a solar eclipse. When the moon is eclipsing the sun, we can actually see the stars around it. And Eddington did two expeditions. He did two. The first one was essentially a bad experience, because he went there and had bad weather. He couldn't see the sun, so he needed to do a second one. The second one was successful, and here's the raw data from that expedition, and you can see that all the stars are moved away a bit from the sun, and his angle, which he measured, is 1.4 to 2.4 arc second. If you repeat the experiment today with radio waves, you get a more precise number, but essentially that was the moment when Einstein became famous, because here you have an experimental test which actually was predicted, and it turned out to be true if you check in Nature for that. It was quite remarkable. So, but what does it mean? If you have a neutron star, which is this blue-white object here on the left, it means that gravity bends light before it hits Earth, for example. It means that you can see on the backside of the object. So it means that if you actually look at a neutron star and you cramp up gravity, you can see above the North Pole and below the South Pole on the backside of the object. And astronomers must take that into account when you observe a neutron star. That is actually something you must take into account, that you see more than the hemisphere of the object. Imagine your own head would be a neutron star, and if you go to a haircut, it would be quite easy to see your back. You don't need two mirrors, just one. And of course, you can now ask the question, can we actually... Can we actually have gravity be so strong that the light rays actually even don't reach Earth anymore? Of course, the answer to that is yes, it can be. And that is the second explanation for a black hole. When you have curved trajectories of light, which are actually closed light rays, so like this one here, it's actually in an orbit of light, so to say. And that's the second explanation. It explains why the light doesn't come out anymore. It tries hard, but it simply does not have enough energy and then falls back to the object itself. That's the second explanation for a black hole. The third one is about a perpetuum mobile. That is a machine which people tried to invent in the 18th century or so, trying to create energy from nothing. Nowadays, if you come with that invention to your local officer, he probably would just ignore you for good reasons, because we know that there's a conservation of energy. That's one of the basic laws of physics. Nevertheless, it's very instructive to think about that here. And that one is even interesting for physicists. I don't know if you know it, then you know the answer, of course. If you don't know it, you will be maybe surprised. surprised by the answer. So how does it work? We have a lamp which shines light via a mirror here up on a solar cell. That solar cell can charge a battery. If you then put that wheel into rotation, you can grab the electricity here and put the power back into the lamp. If you make everything perfect, you get an energy circulation without any gain of energy, loss of energy. You just can make the energy flow like that. However, we haven't thought about Einstein's theory here. We haven't taken into account that famous formula E equals mc square. And what that means is that energy has mass. And the batteries on the front side of the wheel, on the left front side here, these are charged batteries. And on the back side, they are discharged. And the charged batteries have more energy. It means they have more mass. It means that wheel permanently on one side is heavier than on the other side. And if you have a bit of intuition, you can immediately see what will happen. The wheel will start to rotate by itself, and then you can put some generator on the axis and grab the energy from there. And where is the mistake in that thinking? And that mistake is actually in a quite funny point. I'm not sure if everybody in the room who studied physics already knows it. The answer is you have to transport the light back up here against gravity. You have to radiate the light from the lamp up here. And light doesn't like to do that. Light actually loses energy when you send it upwards against gravity. And light cannot get slower. It always moves at the speed of light, but it can change its frequency, its color. It gets redshifted. And that's where the energy gets lost. And that's actually the most easy way to calculate the formula for redshift in the low gravitational field. So it means that light actually fills space-time as a landscape. You can see here, again, the same picture, but I've just overdrawn what happens to light. When you go downwards, it gets a bit shifted towards the yellow or blue side, and if you crawl outward, it then gets red again. It's really like going to the mountains with kids. It's all easy, and people accelerate when you go downwards, but when you walk upwards, then everything gets slower, and the heads get red, and so forth. So that means that our nice blue-white neutron star, actually under strong gravity, will not only show the North and South Pole, but it will actually look at some point red, and at some point it will be infrared, and at some point the wavelength actually is infinite. That means the light has lost all energy. And we have thus three cases of strong gravity which are all identical. One is that what we just talked about, that infinite redshift. That means the light loses all its energy before it has come out. The second explanation we had was that we get closed light trajectories around an object. And the very first one was that the escape speed exceeds the speed of light. And all these limiting cases, they're identical in Einstein's theory. It's just different ways of understanding what we think is a black hole. The basic idea of a black hole actually is quite old. It was already 1783 that John Mitchell from Cambridge had the basic idea. 1916, Albert Einstein put forward his theory, and 1916, Karl Schwarzschild in the same year recognized that there should be something which is a black hole. He didn't name it that way. It was only 1964 that John Wheeler coined that the term which is so prominent now. So, black holes, if I tell you, well, I'm an astronomer here, I have a picture of a black hole, you will say, thank you. I mean, a black screen, that's black holes are invisible by definition. But it's a very classical problem for astronomers. We can actually look for mass, which we don't see. And if you look at the next animation, it's obvious how that works. For example, you have a big star and a small star, and it can just happen that you have a bad telescope, you only see the big star, and you don't see that faint star anymore. And, well, if you have such an orbiting system, you still can see the wobble of the small star due to the of the big star due to the small star, and then you can infer that there must be a second object. And if you know physics rather well, then you can apply the Kepler's laws and Newton's law of gravity, and then you can actually calculate how much mass must there be in the system. So that is a very convenient way to do it. You don't need to see the mass, but you still feel the force of that mass. There's a variant of that which does not work in direct imaging, but it rather works with spectroscopy. Spectroscopy is when you disperse the light into its colors. So if you have a source like a bulb or the sun, send that light through a little glass cube or triangle, and then you get a continuum spectrum which goes from the red via yellow to the blue. It's a very nice, a rainbow is, for example, the best example for that. And if you have some gas in between your light source and your instrument, then actually there's an imprint on the spectrum which are these black lines. And I've shown to you here a real solar spectrum. You can see that there's actually black lines in that spectrum, and these lines are actually on the atmosphere of Sun. So we can see here that the Sun has a cooler atmosphere, which are these lines. And it's a fantastic thing. We don't need to talk much about those lines, but there's one feature which is very, very convenient for astronomers, which is this one here. If you have, again, two objects which are orbiting each other, and both of those show some stellar of these lines, then these lines actually move around in the spectrum. So, for example, when the object is the heavy one is moving away from the observer, then the lines are shifted to the red side, and if the thing is moving towards us, it's shifted into the blue regime of the spectrum. And that's an extremely simple experiment. You just need to take a spectrum, measure where the line is, and you do it again and again, and then you see that these lines are moving. You can even compare it with a laboratory lamp, and by that you already nicely can see, if you then get a sinusoidal pattern, that there's an orbiting motion. And you can essentially, if you know a bit of maths, you can also derive a mass like that. And the third way to see a black hole is, well, a black hole not necessarily is alone in space, but it might have a companion star, for example, and if that companion star blows up, becomes a giant, then the giant might actually become so big that material flows directly over to the black hole. And that probably looks more like that. And you can see that the gas essentially is flowing down onto the black hole, and that is a very violent process. The gravity is so strong that the inflow of material is not smooth, but it's rather, let's say, sketchy. If you have ever tried to drink a bottle of champagne like that, it's not possible. And that's because the pressure of the material inside the bottle is so strong that it's not a smooth flow which would allow you drinking, but you will rather spoil yourself. It's the same effect here, that once the force is too strong, turbulence occurs and you get all sort of mixing processes. In that gas then heats up, the temperatures can reach millions of degrees, and with millions of degrees you radiate in the X-ray regime, and that's why X-ray telescopes are also a good idea to look for black holes, simply because of the high temperature. So, equipped with that, we understand what a black hole is. We also have a decent understanding that we think we can detect one. Let me now come to the massive black hole in our galactic center. First, maybe not everybody in the room knows what a galaxy is. A galaxy is a collection of roughly 100 billion stars. That sounds like a very big number, but it is not. I don't know how much money exactly the US government has at its disposal, but it should be on the order of a few hundred billion per year. That number is correct. At least it's correct in Germany. So if each star would value something like $10, the government could buy a galaxy per year. So it's astronomical numbers in that sense, then the amount of money flowing in a... But just to illustrate how big that number is. And you're actually, in that image, you're seeing all those stars. You're not seeing gas, although the image looks diffuse. But unfortunately, there's a billion stars, and that projector only has 1,000 by 1,000 pixels, which is a million pixels. So you cannot resolve the individual stars on that picture here. So it looks diffuse to you. But be assured, if you zoom in, it turns out all of these things are just little dots. All of those are little suns. And if you look out in the universe, you can see odd galaxies. They have different shapes, and here's a famous example. And in particular, you can see that this galaxy has a bright center. And there's other galaxies which even have super bright centers. Here's an example from the Hubble Space Telescope. You can see here essentially a stellar object, and only if you remove that object, you can see that there's a full galaxy behind. And that is actually quite surprising. There's one central object which apparently is brighter than the light of 100 billion stars. And the only way you can get that much of energy, that was pretty clear in the 60s already, is if you have a supermassive black hole which weighs a million times the mass of the Sun, and you dump essentially every second one Earth mass on that object. That is essentially how you can create those big luminosities. So the idea was around very early, and But the best galaxy to have a look at is, of course, that galaxy which is closest to us, and that is the Milky Way galaxy. You can see here the Milky Way galaxy as observed through a night in Chile. Chile is very advantaged and has a big advantage because it's in the southern sky, and the central part of the Milky Way goes right overhead. It's not as favorable on the northern hemisphere. That's why many observatories go to the southern hemisphere. However, if you take a still of that and you want to take a picture of the Milky Way, you see that, well, there's a lot of black patches here in that image. And that patches are actually not regions where stars are missing, but it's actually just dust. It's dust which screens the light from the stars behind. That's very obvious. I mean, it's 13 point something billion years that nobody has cleaned away the dust. You can imagine how much dust collects in your home if you don't clean for 13 billion years. And that's why we cannot look through that anymore. But there's other waves. You can look through that dust, for example, with radio waves. You know that your mobile phone works in that room, despite the fact that you cannot see the antenna directly. X-rays can penetrate through material. And another way to do it is infrared radiation. Here you can see a sir who has put his hand in a plastic bag, and if you look at the scenery in the infrared, you can see nicely the hand. You see a bit of the bag still, but essentially you can look through that. Infrared radiation is very well known. It's just heat radiation. If you check your house, for example, for thermal leaks, then you use infrared radiation. Or you can see here a cat, of course, in infrared light. It's warm at those positions, those places where you directly see on the skin, so here on the backside of the eye or in the ear, and the tip of the nose of a cat is wet, and that's why it's cool, of course, and you can see that, of course, also here in that infrared image. So taking an infrared image of the Milky Way, here's the optical image and here's the infrared image. And you can see essentially the dust is nearly wiped away. So looking in the infrared is almost having like male eyes, right? You just don't see the dust. And, well, a bit of dust you still see. You must admit that a bit of brown is here. But essentially, the effect is so little that you can cope with it. And you can do observations in the infrared. So where should we put a telescope? And here I've put a world map, which is a Eurocentric world map, I have to admit. But nevertheless, you can see that there's not that much places where people live where you can actually put a telescope. And if you want to go to the southern hemisphere, there's actually much darker skies in Australia, Africa, and South America. And that is where we are actually going.
There was a James Bond movie taken at the telescope, Quantum Solar.
Maybe I can dim that a bit. So that telescope was where the bad guy from James Bond was living in that movie Quantum of Solace. It was blown all in the air and so forth. And but it's actually a wonderful location. I've just been there last week. It's a fantastic place because it's so dry and so high. It's a desert that you can wonderfully observe the stars from there. And the Europeans have collaborated and put together four big telescopes there, which you can see here in the next slide. You can see here. So they are still there. You can see these are the four 8-meter telescopes. These are not the biggest telescopes on Earth. The biggest ones are the ones on Keck, on Mauna Kea in Hawaii. These are the Keck telescopes. These are 8-meter in Hawaii. This is 10-meter. But nevertheless, these are excellent telescopes and a wonderful location. They are roughly at 8,000 feet or so, whereas the clouds here over the Pacific Ocean are only at 3,000 feet, so you're well above the cloud layer at all times. And actually, I'm allowed to show that James Bond music because that was sort of what the James Bond company wrote to the telescope organization afterwards, that they were allowed to use for public outreach the melody. So don't get me on that. I want to go home tomorrow. So if you look at the Galactic Center with such a telescope, you'll find an extremely dense star cluster. You can see here a box which has four light years on a side. And that number is interesting because if the sun were here, the next star, the next neighbor to the sun, Alpha Centauri, would be here. They are four light years apart. And if you take the same volume in the Galactic Center, you can see there would be 10,000, 100,000 of stars in that same volume. And that is quite remarkable. well. So astronomy would be the major subject for every school if you're on a planet around such a star, simply because there's so many stars, that's completely overwhelming. And probably they would not talk about one sun, they have probably several suns in the sky. And the central region is here, and if you actually try to zoom in, you get an image like this, and you can see that image is blurred. It's not sharp anymore. And unfortunately, we do have a nice telescope, but it's standing below Earth's atmosphere. So even if you go into the mountains, you still have to look through the atmosphere. If you think about it, that light has traveled for 25,000 years from the galactic center to Earth, and on the last 10 kilometers through atmosphere, it's actually getting screwed up. How does that look like? It looks like this. If you take a small telescope, look at the moon, you essentially see the image is it's not stable. And if you try to do a long integration on that, you get a blurred image. And one has to admit, that's the advantage of the Hubble Space Telescope. They just fly above the atmosphere. They don't have to deal with that. And you can actually nicely observe from that. However, most people overrate the size of the Hubble Space Telescope. That object is smaller than most American vans. It only has a 2-meter mirror inside, so it's a rather small telescope. It's the sharpest telescope in the optical, but in the infrared, the ground-based astronomers have found a way to overcome that, and I will demonstrate that in the following. Here you can see how a star looks like if you just look at it. But there's a technique called adaptive optics. If you turn on that, all of a sudden your star gets point-like, and you can even see a diffraction ring for those who studied physics around it, which is diffraction at the telescope aperture. That's adaptive optics. It's a technique which was developed twice on planet Earth. It was developed for astronomy. It was developed for the military. The military wanting to look from satellites through the atmosphere down onto Earth, the astronomers the other way around. How does that work, adaptive optics? It's essentially a very cool trick. So you have light coming from the top here. These are plane waves. They are nice and ordered. But if they go through atmosphere, they get this funny shape. And then if you go via a mirror and a lens onto a detector, you get a completely scrambled image at the detector. And the trick with adaptive optics is that you deform your mirror such that those waves are plane again. And then the image is sharp back here. Very clever trick. The only disadvantage is you need to do that roughly 1,000 times per second. So you don't do that once per night, but you have to do it a lot of times. And that's in the beginning. The limitation was to get the real-time computer who can do that. Nowadays, I suppose any of your smartphones, which you probably have with you, could do those calculations easily. 20 years ago, that was the bottleneck for adaptive optics. And the effect of adaptive optics is dramatic. Here you can see the image without adaptive optics. And if you turn it on, that all of a sudden, chuck, the image is sharp. And notice that all of a sudden, a lot of fainter stars pop out. And the group I'm working with, we have done a very simple experiment. We've looked at that region of the sky simply patiently long enough. And here you can see two images, 2002. That is when I was not working at that group yet. You can see here three stars, a bulk of smaller stars. In 2006, that's an image I was taking myself. You can see here the same three stars as here. But if you look at that region here, you can see that somehow the scenery has changed. Within 4 years, that doesn't look the same anymore. And here, let me now put together 16 of these images, just taken very simply each year, one of those images. And how that looks like is shown here. And that is something you have to digest maybe a bit. But if you look at this object here, you can see that that object actually is flying around on a trajectory. And you can just draw the trajectories here. Is that me? It's a ship. So you can see nicely how these stars follow Keplerian ellipses. And at the position where they fly around, there's actually no source seen. Well, and what can you do with that now? We know the orbit takes 16 years. We know the distance to the object. You can calculate everything with that. You can calculate, in particular, the mass of the unseen object here. The answer, which comes out, is absolutely stunning. The result is 4.3 million solar masses. Most astronomers at that point said only, wow, okay. And I mean, it's not about Einstein. This is Newtonian gravity. You have to disbelieve Newtonian gravity if you don't believe that there's 4 million solar masses. And that's a very, we typically get once every week, we get some crackpot writing to us that you're crazy, black holes cannot exist because. But we are not relying on Einstein here. Most people have difficulties with Einstein's theory, but the problem here is Newton's theory. And I have just a movie here which tries to summarize that part of the talk again. We zoom into the galactic center, which is in the constellation of Sagittarius. So we zoom into these dust clouds, and we have to shift then to go to red wavelengths. So we have to go towards the infrared to actually still see something. You can see that now we're pretty much hitting the dust, so we should rather go to the infrared. Doing that, you can see there's new stars popping up. Here comes this red, the still reddened part, which is that very compact central cluster of the Milky Way. And you can see how nicely that comes now closer. The image is a bit unsharp. Now it's the point where we need adaptive optics. You can see it's ugly. We really turn on adaptive optics better at that point. Doing that, there is that central arc second. And now plays again that 16-year movie. Also realize 16 years is longer than a PhD thesis. Even in the US, you get a PhD thesis faster than that. But 16 years, an institute can do that. That's something which is on a scale of an institute, not of an individual researcher. So if you take all these stars and make a computer model for that, the model turns out to be extremely simple, because the motions of 40 stars which we observe there can be explained by the presence of simply one single dark mass in the center, which is what we think is the black hole. Okay, now let me turn to our recent discovery, what happens around that black hole. Essentially, I've already seen these adaptive optics, and adaptive optics is correcting the effects of Earth's atmosphere, but it's doing it in a very unfair way. Namely, if you're having good weather at the telescope, you will get excellent data. And if you're having bad weather, your data will be worth nothing at all. So it's not actually leveling out that everybody gets more or less the same images. It creates even a bigger injustice between good and bad weather astronomers. And so when we're at the telescope, we have good weather, sometimes we have bad weather. And during all those years which we have been doing the observations, we sometimes had bad weather and took those images at a longer wavelength than where the adaptive optics is not as crucial and still is more or less. Those data were B-rated. We essentially piled them up on a big hard drive and never really looked at them. In 2011, we decided to have a systematic look at those data. And the first thing which came to our mind is, wow, there's differences. You can see here one of our high-resolution images taken in April 2011 in K-band. That essentially means at 2 micron wavelength, and it shows hot emission. You can see here all the stars. This is the star which flies around in 16 years. Here's the position of the black hole. And the same scenery just a few months later when there was bad weather at the telescope, and that was then in L-band, which is 4 microns. So the wavelength is twice as big, so the image is intrinsically a factor 2, less sharp, and you can see at that wavelength colder emission. And you can see here's an object which is not present here. But there's other objects. Have a look. Those two guys, they are missing here as well. So it's not the only object, but there's a few objects which are present in the colder images, but not on the other side. And you can even estimate the temperature from that. The object must have a temperature of around 600 Kelvin, which is more or less the temperature of a pizza oven. So that is it's rather cool compared to the stars who have a few thousand Kelvin. And well, once you know what you have to look for, we could go backwards. So in 2011, but we can go back to our 2000. You see that. And it was very obvious from the very first look at it. Well, that thing is moving closer to the position of the black hole. That thing seems to fly right towards the black hole. And we were actually able to fully determine the orbit of that cloud. You can see here that is the orbit of the star, which goes around in 16 years, and that is the orbit of that gas cloud. It moves at 3,000 kilometers per second. That's probably around 2,000 miles per second. I don't know what the unit for that would be here. The orbit is very elliptic, as you can see, and the period of that orbit is 200 years. And in particular, we were able to predict that the closest approach is in 2014. So in 2011, we knew that in 3 years, that object will be very, very close to the black hole. But where did that come from? Where? How is it possible that there's something which is not a star? So let me again show one of those movies of the stars. You can see here all that chaotic system. And we have, of course, the orbits in full 3D, so you can see how all these stars are flying around the black hole there. It's a slight time lapse, of course, in that movie. And it looks essentially like a swarm of bees if you look at that zoom level. However, if you take your telescope and zoom a bit out, then you can see actually that further out there's a few stars which seem to lie all in one plane. If you, I don't know if you can capture it from 3D. I think in the next step the movie will actually highlight that particular plane. So you can see now we're edge on for most of those orbits. There's a few orbits which are mostly coplanar in that, but they are at larger radii. And one can show that disk which is there outlined actually has something on the order of 50 stars or so. So that's how the disk is lying there. And it turns out that the orbit of the object we just found, that this orbit is coplanar with that stellar disk. So it's very likely that the object which we have discovered has to do something with that disk of stars. So it probably somehow came from one of these stars, or is one of those stars. The first idea you can have, for example, is it simply is coming from stellar winds. Here you can see a simulation of the stellar winds in the Galactic Center, which was done in the year 2006 already. You can tell that was a theory person working on that simulation because the stars are black dots. It's probably the worst way to denote a star with a black dot. But you can see how these stars are spitting out material and how that material gets clumpy. And it turns out that the clumps are more or less the size and mass of what we also see here. And if you look at our images, there's actually two of those disk stars, this one and that one here, both of which could well be the origin for the gas cloud, which is located roughly here. That's one of the ideas. The second idea is, that was an idea put forward by colleagues in Harvard, that it's a disk around a young star. If you look, for example, at the Orion Nebula, you can see many, many objects which are stars, but which have sort of a disk around them. And if such an object would be happening to come close to the black hole, which is here drawn in blue, what would happen? That disk would essentially feel the gravity of the black hole. It would be ripped apart due to the tidal shear, and then that material would fill up a large volume, and the surrounding stars would illuminate that, and that essentially would create the emission we are seeing. If you look at that model, if the star is moving closer to the black hole, that effect should get stronger. That means you would lift more gas, and you would then essentially have a brighter object. And the prediction is that after discovery, that object should have become brighter. So our observations, however, show that more or less that was constant over time. So, but any good theorist, of course, always can change his theory such that you can still match the data. So I'm not sure. But there's ideas out what this object actually is. We don't really know its physical nature. It's just open. But what is clear is that such a gas cloud will not survive 2014. You can see here a very simple simulation. You take a bunch of gas particles, throw it at a black hole, and you can see that it gets spaghettified, it gets longer and thinner. That's the effect of the tidal forces. It's essentially the same effect as is happening to this sir here, which is approaching a black hole, and essentially he gets also spaghettified. And we actually are lucky enough that we can witness that. That is absolutely stunning. For me as an astronomer, I would never have been able to think that that observation would be possible. Nevertheless, with the VLT, we've done that observation. We are using an instrument which is called Symphony. It's below the main mirror. It's that little thing here, that is that tank here. And the mirror is here, that's the 8-meter mirror. What we get from that instrument is actually not really images, but we are getting data cubes. So, and a data cube means that we have an image, and in each point we have a full spectrum behind. So that is actually a 3D structure in your computer. And What you can do then is, of course, you need a complicated viewing program, because that information is so, you cannot look at 3D information, you only can look at 2D information, so you need to cut through a data cube like this to really get out your information. And one way to do it is you take out a position velocity diagram, which is a diagram which you obtain by cutting through like this. You cut along a positional axis, and the other axis is along wavelength. By means of the Doppler effect, that means that this is also a velocity. And the diagram looks like this, rather unimpressive. Here's the position axis, here's the wavelength axis. For example, at this position, there's something which is shining at all wavelengths. That means that object is a star. Or here's, for example, a dark line which is present at all positions but always at the same wavelength. That is a spectral line which is coming from Earth's atmosphere. But we are not limited to do that. If you have a small kid and you give a knife to a kid and you ask, please cut the cake, what would a kid do? It would never cut along a straight line, but it would maybe cut along a funny figure through the cake. And we decided to cut along the orbit of that object. We know that orbit, and we can cut exactly along that. And doing that, we get a position velocity diagram which looks like that. It doesn't really show much of a difference, you think. But if you look up here, there's actually quite a significant difference. Here's an emission line. That emission line is a hydrogen line, and you can see here in the blow-up, this is the line, and there's some emission offset from that. And now let me clean the diagram, get rid of that star here, get rid of that hydrogen emission, and then you essentially see here is some curved trajectory, and that is exactly that gas cloud. So it means that it's moving at a high velocity, it's offset from its line at the certain position. And we were actually able to have on the order, I think it's 8 diagrams which we have collected so far. The first one we were able to get in 2004, so that the data cube was there in 2011, but we just never looked at the data in that way. You needed first to make that funny cut through the data cube. And you can see here there's emission essentially unresolved in both dimensions. Not much of a change in 2006, but have a look at the 2008 data set. In 2008, you can see that that object seems to be tilted in the diagram. And you have to think about that for a second. What does that mean? It means the front part is at higher velocities than the back part. Think about a train. If the front carriage is moving faster than the back carriage of your train, it's not very healthy for the train. The train is being stretched at that moment. And that is exactly what that diagram is showing. You're seeing the stretching of the object. 2008, 2010, 2011, that was the data we had at hand when we discovered it. 2012, we were really happy when we reobserved it, that the stretching continued. 2013, in April, you can see how that went on, and here, August, September 2013, that's the latest I can show you here. And you can see, it's a very poor man's movie, but it contains a lot of expensive telescope time, but you can see how the spaghettification of a black hole is acting right under our eyes. Within a few years, you can see how that object is being spaghettified. So, if we look again at that series of diagrams here, and I showed you that simple, stupid simulation before. If you project that simulation into the same type of diagram, you get actually this. And just look at the blue dots here and compare with the shape up here. You can see that the shape is very well matched, and even that overshooting gas here in 2012 is predicted by that simulation. That is just some unlucky particles which are on even higher eccentric orbits. And you can see that some of the gas already has swing over on the other side here in 2013, and that's also what the simulation predicts. That's that bit of emission here, which is here. It's not highly significant, but it also tells you that was April 2013, and that whole event actually is centered on 2014, March, but it actually takes a year. And again, think of a train. If a train passes by, you cannot really ask in which millisecond the train is passing by, simply because it takes maybe a few seconds until that roller coaster train has passed in front of your eyes. And that is a very difficult thing. I have tomorrow a press conference here where I again need to explain to journalists, we cannot give you a date when this is happening. It's happening over 18 months, that event, that gas cloud is flying by. It's a long spaghetti which takes its time, and we cannot assign a single date to that. But I'm sure I will get that question tomorrow. When will it happen? And well, that's not all. I mean, I haven't we haven't really thought about one effect, namely that the black hole is not just by itself, but the black hole does have an atmosphere. The black hole is surrounded by an atmosphere. Here you can see a simulation how that atmosphere should look like. Here, that would be the size of the black hole, and that's the innermost region of that atmosphere. And a simulation of how that cloud is falling through that atmosphere is given here. That's the black hole. The stars are in only for beautifying the image. You should look at the gas cloud. And you can see, as it's falling in, it's getting essentially tidally stretched. That's all what is happening. A bit of tail you get, okay, that's fine. But mostly you see it's tidally being torn apart, getting longer and longer, spaghettified. But that changes in 2014, namely now. Now it looks like a drop of milk in your coffee. Now all of a sudden it starts to mix with the ambient gas. And you can see it's completely destroyed. It's covered a huge space now. And there's a funnel of material which is raining back onto the black hole. And that is, of course, something which is quite interesting, if material makes it to the black hole. Already now, when we look at our black hole, here, for example, is a data set from 2007, which I just picked out. That is that star which goes around in 16 years. And you should look at that position here. You can see that from time to time, there something is shining up. And that is actually emission coming from around the black hole. That happens mostly once per night. It lasts more or less 90 minutes. And that emission is a very, very red characteristic light. And we think we understand that this is material which is essentially very close to the black hole. But these flares are different. These flares are from material which is going around the black hole, and you have something like a thunderstorm on that accretion disk. You have something like a lightning flash or something like a magnetically powered event. It's very different if you would take the same system and pull in additional gas. You would essentially have something like that. Then material would spiral down. It's a very different process. It's not a magnetically powered thing, but it's really driven by gravity. I think it's honest to say nobody really knows what a black hole will do. Maybe it will do that. And I'm an observational astronomer, and I say we'd better watch. We'd better take our telescope and look at the Galactic Center for the coming months. And let me just conclude by saying I think we have interesting stuff ahead. Thanks a lot for your attention.
Okay, we can take a few questions
for Dr. Gillessen. I'll run the mic over to you.
If the period of that glass cloud was 200 years, was part of it consumed 200 years ago? And number two, the reason why it's going to be completely consumed now is the orbit has changed enough that it's too close to the black hole, and that's what's swallowing it in?
No, we don't know if that gas cloud was present 200 years ago. Actually, if it is a pure gas cloud, it cannot have been 200 years ago already present, because then it would have been destroyed during the pericenter passage already. So the simulations show you can have that gas cloud falling towards the black hole, but it will never fall away from the black hole again, simply because it gets messed up at that point. So it means if that is a gas there's not a stellar source inside. That phenomenon is sort of it only happens once for each gas cloud. It's a very dangerous approach, so to say. But let's say we do know, for example, that the black hole of in the galactic center probably was brighter by a huge factor roughly 300 years ago, simply because we see X-ray echoes in the interstellar medium. So that hints towards that the black hole at that time was brighter by a factor, I don't know, Daryl, don't get me wrong, 10,000, 100,000. Just a few hundred years ago. So maybe currently the black hole is particularly faint, and now you just give it a little bit and then it could brighten up substantially. For that gas cloud, it's particularly unlucky, yes.
Okay, and more questions? Yep.
Can you comment on Stephen Hawking's recent change of mind about a black hole?
No, I'm an observational astronomer. but let me say that I think the press has picked it up wrongly. I think he did not mean black holes do not exist. He did not say that. He only claimed that if you approach a black hole, you would see something different than what one has thought before. I think that's all. But I, to be honest, I don't understand this type of theoretical physics. I can measure a mass via Newtonian gravity at a world-class telescope. That's my job.
Another question here.
What range of infrared wavelengths are you observing?
Well, we are limited on the one side by the thermal background of the atmosphere. So going beyond 5 or 8 microns, essentially, you then would only see the radiation of Earth's atmosphere, which is still minus 70 degrees Celsius. So that radiation limits on the one hand. On the other hand, if you go beyond 1.3 microns to smaller wavelengths, you cannot look through the dust anymore. And it turns out that the sweet spot is around 2 microns, where you actually want to look at. 4 microns is also okay. You saw those images, they are a bit flaky. 1.5 microns, the adaptive optics is not really working as well, plus the dust is worse. So 2 microns is usually the spot where people try to be.
Okay. Further questions?
Can you give us an idea exactly what that gas or dust is that you're talking about?
What do you mean, what it is?
Yeah, what it is. I know what Earth is made of, and I know what the sun's made of, but what's that dust particles up there made
of? So the gas cloud is consisting out of hydrogen and helium. We see hydrogen and helium gas. We see it in its atomized form. We don't see hydrogen as a molecule. We don't see that. We have checked for that. And the dust, we only can see via its temperature. It's typically silicates or graphites. So it's really something like we would call dust on Earth. It's probably very, very, very similar. And it turns out that that dust is present in all those images. You've seen some red diffuse emission that's all coming from dust. There are some stars which actually produce dust because they have a lot of carbon in their atmospheres, and that creates simply dust. And this dust is spit out into the universe and flies around and mixes very well with the gas.
Just the world's largest dust bunny.
Sorry?
The world's largest dust bunny.
Yeah.
Other questions?
Here, right in the front, this one.
Okay.
Have you observed any gravitational lensing of any of the stars that are going by? For instance, I saw a flash when one of the stars went by. Was that gravitational lensing?
No. The reason is gravitational lensing works best if the lens is halfway between the source and the observer. That's when gravitational lensing is best, whereas those stars are very close to the black hole and we are very far away. That means the magnification of the gravitational lensing is very, very, and the images of these images, these lensed images, they must exist, but they are on the order of 10 magnitudes fainter. 10 magnitudes is a lot. That's the difference between Sun and Jupiter or something like that. There's no way we can serve these now. But there's an Italian group who constantly, for each orbit update which we give, they check again. If not, maybe in 1 year there would be the chance that we can detect one of those flashes.
Are any of the stars close to the black hole on orbits that would be occluded by the black hole were they to pass behind it?
I didn't quite understand.
So are any of the stars close to the black hole going to go behind it at some point?
You mean fall into it?
No, I mean be on the other side of it from us.
Oh, yeah, sure. An orbit always has that mass in the middle, and half of the orbit is on one side, the other half is on the other side of the black hole. So if you think about Earth has the moon, and the moon is for part of its orbit on one side, and for the other part, it's on the other side of Earth.
But eclipsed is what I meant.
Eclipse. Then we would need essentially an orbit which is exactly edge on. I think there's one which is coming pretty close to that, but the alignment is, I mean, you don't reach that level of alignment by chance, I think. You would need to position Earth to exactly observe that eclipse.
Can you identify any gravitational redshifts from the stars that pass close by the black hole?
Not yet. So we measure radial velocities for those stars by means of their spectral lines, and the radial velocity only given by the orbital motion at the moment, but the radial velocity shoots up to 10,000 kilometers per second. And the redshift effects are on the order of 50 kilometers per second. And so yes, that should be doable. We just need that star to be particularly close to the black hole. That star on a 16-year orbit was last close in 2002. At that time, infrared spectroscopy didn't exist in its current form. But 2018 is not too far from now. And I'm pretty sure, yes, we will see it.
OK, we'll do two quick last questions. Not you, him, sorry.
This simulation for this kind of milk in the coffee cloud effect goes up to 2043 here. So do you think that if there is some sort of event going on that's, you know, emits a lot of something to observe, it will be happening frequently as this kind of like tails back in and we'll be able to see it for a very long time?
Well, that particular simulation was, of course, assuming a certain type of atmosphere and so forth, and thereby the scale might be wrong by a factor of three easily on that. It might take a factor of three longer or a factor of three shorter. I would not exclude that. Yet we do know that we have observed the Galactic Center at reasonable resolution since 1992 and at high resolution since 2002, and it never has happened something dramatic since then. That's the best we can say. Plus, we do know that 300 years ago, it must have been brighter by a substantial factor for maybe a year or two. I don't know what the current estimate is. That. So I think it's not unreasonable to think that that black hole simply sometimes gets a bit of food and sometimes it doesn't. You must imagine that gas cloud has a total mass which is only three times the mass of Earth. That must be a very tiny snack for a 4 million mass black, 4 million solar mass black hole. Yet it is a major snack because the black hole is getting so little food that it would even react to that little extra. It's completely underfed. No human would survive on that level of feeding.
Yes, my question is that as this dust comes in, and obviously it'll get a lot brighter, and would that radiation pressure of the gas heating up cause any changes in the inflow of gas? Would it cause some of it to blow away, or would it not be strong enough to affect, or would it be a negligible impact because there's not enough gas?
I think the honest answer is we don't know.
Okay.
So I've asked simulators if they can simulate that, and the answer is it's simply impossible to simulate that. It covers such a wide range of dynamics that we don't know so much about the system, so you would need to run millions of simulations to vary all your parameters which you want, and that essentially they said, come on, let's wait 2 years and we see what's going to happen. It's not worth the effort to simulate that. But of course, it will be the most powerful tool once in a couple of years from now, when all the observations are finished. It will be very constraining, and because then we have conducted an experiment. We've thrown a compact gas cloud. It was compact in 2008 at the black hole. We have essentially seen something or not, and we have seen it dilute or not or whatever. And then you need to figure out what does that mean for that atmosphere around the black hole, and that is probably one of the biggest uses of that cloud. It's a particularly nice thing that it might light up the black hole. That might be fundamental or not, but the fundamental point is that we will probably understand better how the atmosphere around the black hole is arranged. And that is, of course, true for most of the black holes in the universe. Most of the black holes are in that state, like our own black hole, that they are really, really faint, are not really being fed. The only way to understand it is that they need a particular shape of atmosphere around it, and we can hopefully test that in the future. One last sentence. I think there was predictions that there should be, as the cloud approaches, that there should be a shock front, because that cloud moves at roughly Mach 2, so two times the speed of sound, so you should get a shock front, and nothing was observed of that shock front. That already must be constraining for the atmosphere. I haven't really seen anybody working on that, but already that must be telling that the atmosphere probably is not as dense or more concentrated than what was thought before.
Okay. On behalf of the Division of Astrophysics and the American Physical Society, we'd like to thank Dr. Gillessen for this wonderful talk. If you're interested in these topics, we have more on this in the Hot Topics session of the Division of Astrophysics. I forget which day it's on, but you can look it up, and we'll have more on similar things. Let's thank him now.